love the, I know we have a pepper show.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Jessica Lopez Lyman. I teach in the Department of Chicano Latino Studies. I'm one of the organizers of this symposium and really excited to see all of you. Some of our students are getting here, which is great because they're gearing up for finals, so thanks for being here as well. This is the first out of two roundtables that are dedicated to looking at the work from the six artists that we have the exhibit Remembrance. All of the artists are from Los Angeles, and well, actually, that's not true. You came from Spain, but a little further away, just a little bit. So we're really grateful for all of them for making the trip here and for being able to share their work and their personal journeys with us. So similar to the previous panel, the artists have some slides to show of their work, and then we also have some questions regarding their process. We'll open it up for questions to the audience afterwards. I want to introduce each person before we begin. So I will start with the first person to my left. Luciano Martinez is a multidisciplinary visual artist born from Mexican immigrants and raised on a ranch in South Texas. His works range from watercolor and graphite illustrations to art installations and wall murals. Luciano graduated from the Art Center College of Design and Branding Experiences in Design. While in school, he continued to work his illustrations into his designs, creating a distinctive style which has honored him a Gold Moonbeam Award and an International Latino Book Award. When he is not exhibiting in galleries or working on branding projects, Luciano teaches workshops at Artworks LA and has contributed articles to Catapult Magazine. Luciano is currently working on a contemporary arts magazine titled Blow Pop. Blow Pop magazine is now in its third volume, which will be released in July of 2017. Luciano has worked with such brands as Red Bull Energy Drinks, Paper Culture, Urban Decay, Colgate, My Friends Love Me, the Bellevue Collection, and has collaborated with design companies. The second panelist we have today is Rigo Maldonado. Many of them. There we go. So, Rigo Maldonado is a mixed media contemporary artist and educator from California. His installations fabricate hyper-real and contradictory environments that explore Mexican cultural tradition, counter-memory, social amnesia, and community building. Maldonado confronts his audiences with complex social issues through playful spatial manipulations of found objects and new technologies, always with a nod to the ironic and excessive. Maldonado's work has been exhibited in galleries and public spaces throughout the US and Mexico, China, including Self-Help Graphics, Social and Public Art Resource Center, and Dartmouth College. Maldonado co-curated the groundbreaking Hijas de Juarez exhibit at Spark. His narrative on bringing awareness to the femicides through art and activism has been published in Making a Killing, Femicide, Free Trade, and La Frontera by the University of Texas Press. Currently, Maldonado co-owns an art gallery, Auto Erotica, in Palm Springs, and is a high school ceramics teacher in his hometown of Santa Ana. And then the final panelist we have today is Ruben Esparza. He's an artist and independent curator based in Los Angeles. Esparza's practice spans painting, drawing, and digital work, mixing it with elements of conceptualism, ethnicity, and queer culture. His curatorial work focuses on underrepresented artists, primarily in the queer and ethnic communities. His work is included as part of the permanent collections of the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, Museum of Contemporary Art San Diego, the Santa Barbara Museum, National Museum of Mexican Art Chicago, Illinois, among others. He has created events and curated exhibitions across the United States, Latin America, and Europe. Ruben is the founder and lead curator of the Queer Biennial, anchored in Los Angeles, New York, Mexico, Miami, Paris, and Zurich. So please give me a warm welcome to the panelists. So similar to the previous panel, we asked this very broad question, which might be a little too broad, but we really want you to be able to tell stories in these narratives here, this panel. So we want to ask first if you could briefly describe your journey to becoming an artist. And then I can also show slides if you want.
Should we start this way?
Sure.
Well, I think for me, it all really started when I was, well, my parents first were immigrants. They were working in the fields, constantly going from south to north and back down. And so I think for us, we had very little money. We were very, very poor. There was 12 of us, 12 siblings, 9 boys and 3 girls. And so we didn't have too much of anything. So when I started really getting into art was I was about 6 years old, and my mom had some pencil lying around, and she would go grocery shopping, and this was during the times when you could actually get paperbacks for free. So I would take the paperbacks and rip them up and start drawing Virgin Marys for her. And my mom if you're hardcore Mexican from a rancher background, they're very, very much into the Mexican mysticism and the religious iconography. And so when I started making these Virgin Marys for her, I could see her light up. And my mom had a lot of pressure. I mean, she had 12 kids, you know, they had to go work at the fields and all that. So when I would make these Virgin Marys for her, I could see her really, there was something within her that just lit up. And for me, it felt really special. And at that age, I really wasn't getting a lot of attention from my mother, because obviously there was a lot of us. So just to get that little bit of attention from her, from me just drawing some simple Virgin Marys, was something very special. So I just kept doing them and doing them until she keeps stacking them. Of course, she wouldn't throw them away, because that would be a little bit blasphemous. But that would be like, oh my God, something's gonna happen to us. So she would just keep them. And for me, I thought, oh, she kept them because she thought that was special. Later on, I realized that she just probably thought it would be really difficult for her to throw away. But I think that's where I really started getting into this spiritual side of my parents. And for a very, very long time, they had this one foot into this mysticism, this curanderos, this spiritual aspect of, you know, the Mexican culture. And then the other foot, they had this religious aspect, which was Catholicism, iconography, you know, Jesus, Virgin Mary. And what was very interesting is, I'm not sure how it would be in Mexico, but in America, I think they felt very, very shy about the spiritual aspect, the metaphysical aspect, the mysticism. And said they kept it very quiet. And for me, I felt very ashamed of this part of my life. We were growing up, and my dad would be walking around with this incense, you know, that they burn, and he would walk around the house, cleansing the house and saying prayers in Spanish. Of course, we'd be trying to cover our clothes because we started smelling like smoke in high school and junior high and all that. And people would keep saying, "This smells like a firewood around here," and we'd be like, "Oh my God, it's us." It's like my dad was. So I felt so awkward about these moments, and you know, it was a really a big struggle. I mean, I really pulled away from this metaphysical aspect of our culture. And it wasn't until later on that I got out that, you know, I stopped doing art for a little while, and then I went through, of course, the gay identity issues, trying to accept this, who I was, and trying to also connect in a spiritual way, not just to gay people, but to straight people. I just had this disconnection to everyone. And whenever I started going back into drawing and stuff, I started really sort of just naturally gravitate to iconography, to things that look angelic, things that looked, all of it was somewhat depressing, because I think religious iconography is like really sort of depressing and morbid. But I kind of liked it. So I started gravitating towards that. And it wasn't until I think I started asking my mom and dad about curanderos, and I started saying, you know, I kind of remember going to curanderos, but they never talked about it. And my dad told me of a story just recently. I said, how old was I to go to the first curandero? And my dad goes, you were 5 months old. And I says, wow, 5 months old. I don't remember that. But he says, yeah, you know, we've been taking you to Curanderos for a very long time. And so I felt like this was this natural connection that I had to the spiritual realm. I felt this natural connection to the metaphysical realm, where I felt like, okay, this is why I've always been drawn to energy, drawn to people, whether people have gravitated towards me or have gravitated towards them, and why I've always kind of trusted my gut instincts. So in the work that I started doing within those years where I really started focusing on this energy, I still felt slightly embarrassed, but I felt that, and I loved contemporary art, I loved all these new artists popping up, I felt, how can I convey this work in a very accepting manner, in a style and a look that people wouldn't be like, oh my God, that's voodoo, or oh my God, that's like Santeria, or something that where they wouldn't be degrading and scared of. So I really started working with character design, character art. And since I went to art school for branding and design, I learned a lot about this kind of work. So I mixed both of them together, and I can show you some work. So this is called Mis Santos Espantosos, and I often work with collaborators because I hate doing stuff that, you know, might look kind of raggedy. And I worked with my friend Amy Van Gilder on this. Amy was one of the first Muppet makers. She actually worked with Big Jim Henson in New York to create the Muppets. She worked on Kermit, Miss Piggy. She also worked on Fraggle Rock. She worked with David Bowie on The Labyrinth. So she worked on this with me, but it was a little bit of a work because I wanted to bring a sexual aspect to it without being so sexual. And because the gay community really celebrates leather and celebrates vinyl and this leather community, I felt that I really wanted to touch on something like that. And the reason it's called Mis Santos Espantosos is that there is this, essentially these are symbols of my fears of sexuality, my fears at the time of being exposed to being actually a sexual person. So I felt like these little characters were these sort of little things that you would find in some pyramid or whatnot that would represent sexuality, this sort of like dark but not dark, you know, very sensual aspect of them. And so that these were some of the starts. This was my take on a curandero. And once again, this is where I was using a lot of the sort of simplistic, the character design to make people want to be around them, to want to hug them, want to be, just to touch them and everything. And so I worked with Amy on this as well. And actually there was a woman who bought this piece and put it in her condo in this really amazing hotel in the middle of LA. She put it in front of her doorway, and literally this thing is huge, and in front of her doorway, she said, you know, I love the aspect that it feels like it's projecting this positive energy. And so I went further along with some of the work and decided to do another curandero, which this one was a winter one. I felt like I really started looking into indigenous cultures and start looking into the different types of curanderos, the energy curanderos, the plant curanderos, and all that. And I really started focusing on creating this sort of world that these curanderos were coming into our lives to help us. And not only could adults really relate to it, but children too. And I think as adults and as we're going further in our evolution, I believe that we need to start teaching the children that we need to reconnect again to this energy, to this natural phenomenon that's been going on in the world. So, and once again, this is more of an illustration, but this was inspired by some old illustrations where, you know, there was this, I believe a lot that there's worlds beyond this world, and also believe that there's entities that, who knows, have, I mean, I do believe that there's like these stories that people always feel so awkward to talk about, but for me, I like to investigate these interdimensional beings, these beings that might be from another planet that have kind of come into our lives and sort of altered how we see things. And for this one, I think that I was going through a lot of angst, and I started really reading about self-healing. And so I started working with illustrations on how to heal oneself. And so that's where this drawing came in. This was some of the newer pieces that I did in Spain. I've been working a little bit with Sanguina. So I started working a lot more with the concept of interdimensional indigenous people coming into this world, because I think I was so fed up with this whole Trump thing and the idea that the planet's being destroyed, you know, and so many people have voted for this person who was very gung-ho about not only putting down Mexicans and other cultures, but also just sort of, it's almost like a bulldozer going off of rainforest. You kind of feel like this primitive, but this also very modern idea of spirituality is being trampled over with. And so it really inspired these drawings to draw like these entities or these animal spirits or these creatures to really sort of tap into this place where I thought would be whimsical, but yet we can be very serious about it. And that's why I use Sangina. It's like, you know, it's a very serious, I mean, you really have to master the drawing technique and everything. I mean, it took me a year to seriously, not to do this, but it took me a year of practice to work with Sangina. And, you know, I just felt like this real intense feeling when I was drawing it, but yet it's really whimsical and very accepting to all types of people. So that was, and this was a, this idea came the day after I heard about Jesus, and when they contacted me and they told me the next day we were flying to Spain and we were leaving in the morning, they contacted me in the afternoon of the day before. And they told me, and I was incredibly upset, and at some point me and my partner were thinking, should we even go? And I mean, we had all this already planned, and so we decided to go. And I didn't get much sleep. And as the plane, when we went into the plane and everything was going on, I looked out the window, and as we were flying up into the air, the sun was setting. So there was this enormous sunset going over this clouds. And I felt like I was in heaven. I felt like this is heaven. And I thought to myself, God, you know, I hope you're in a better place and I hope you're happy. And so I looked down and I thought to myself, how silly as human beings we can really be when we start thinking about our lives and we start looking up into the sky and we start asking, we don't know if they're there or not, but we start really praying to make us feel connected, to make us feel loved. And so that was the big question for this installation. I thought, what if there's no one there, but I can create someone there? You know, because I'm not sure if I believe that there is a God, but I do believe in universal energy. But I thought to myself, what if I create something that people can believe in? And so that's where I worked a lot of this. And from that whole scene and the whole feeling, I brought this character in. And I made him like this little god that rules the heavens, and these mountain monks that are constantly, you know, praying out to him, and it's representative of the way people are. And whether we believe in gods or not, that's besides the fact. To me, the fact that we have these beings that we've created, there's still a comfort to us. When we lose people, when we feel down, when we feel depressed, I mean, I find myself praying sometimes to a god that I don't even know how I believe in. And to me, I mean, it's a very positive thing, you know, and I think that continuing my work, I will still be working with a lot of this idea of gods and creating our own world, because we really don't know if this world exists. But it doesn't really matter in the end. If we find some peace and find some connection, I think that that is our human capabilities, and we can do a lot of good by saying God wants us to do this, or God wants us to accept each other, love each other. It doesn't matter who you are. You know, if my God says love all gay people as you would love other people or whatnot, I mean, so be it. I mean, there is a purpose, and that purpose is up to us, I think. So, I think that's. So that's it.
Thank you so much. Pico, do you want to share your...
Well, thanks for giving me coffee.
I'm trying to be lighthearted. So I grew up in a family that my dad's a carpenter and my mom painted houses, so it was a very religious background. And growing up with three older sisters, I call myself a lot by myself. And so I would like in the blocks of that my dad would get the wood, and I would start building little things around the house. And so I started doing these little installations in my house. And then I started noticing my mom was doing like all these things with fabrics and flowers for the Virgin Guadalupe, or this saint or that saint. So like my house was kind of an installation, but art was not a word in our house that we use. Mm-hmm. Art was for white people, right? So it was not for us. And it was just like, well, we just decorate our house the way we want to, right? So I learned a lot of my actually installation art from watching my mother do her own installations within our house, right? And so it wasn't, I started getting involved in organizing. I was in Mecha, like a lot of us were, Mecha, and I started organizing, and I was the official poster boy. I was like, everybody go to him to make the posters. You know, you want a good UFW Eagle? Go to him. And even though I never took any art classes, I still had that ability to be creative. And I got really involved in organizing different communities. And it wasn't until I was at UCLA, I had no idea I was an artist. And then Judy Baca told me, she's like, Huck, you're an artist, like, we're not practicing. And I'm like, I am, really? You know? So it was until then that I started really looking at the concept of loss. And when I started doing work on loss, it was based on Day of the Dead and based on altar-making, because I figured that, hey, I already know how to do installations, let's put it all together. So I started doing a lot of installation work with altars. I started off traditional, like you're supposed to have the 7 layers or the 11 layers, and then from there I moved on to more conceptual stuff, where I was integrating video, I was integrating fashion into honoring people. By the time I was 17, I had lost already 14 friends due to gun violence, so that was a way for me to understand the process of death, but also understand that I can honor somebody and let them live still through these honorings. And so I started doing a lot of work with Day of the Dead altar making, and it was not until I started coming out at 25 that I started really researching into myself, and this whole aspect of desire started coming in. I started really looking into the idea of like, what is loss and what is desire, right? And so I had to kind of contemplate that for a while. And in the terms of desire, I started, my own coming out process was kind of documented through my own artwork. It was a way for me to tell my story through an artist's version, right? So I started doing a lot of videos of me. I started really looking into what hypersexuality is, what it was masculinity, what was femininity. So the work that you see in the gallery, it deals with more of the desire aspect of it and loss. At the time, And I lost a couple of friends due to HIV complications. And I remember going to the hospice and seeing one of my friend Max. And I looked around and I'm like, I don't see him. Where is he at? You know, I know he's here. And I had to ask two different nurses if that was Max. And it was Max. His body had deteriorated so much that I didn't recognize him anymore. And so I started exploring the whole aspect of loss and really started looking at this whole idea of fetishism and with the way men turn to sex to feel loved, right? And so when I started exploring the whole idea of splashing, which is, it's called messy fun. And this was kind of from the 1970s, where it first started in Britain, where they would use substance like foods, anything liquidy to, as a sexual desire. And this is when the age of the internet just started, and I put a Craigslist ad, and I was like, is anybody out there into splashing? I just wanted to try it out, so I put my little Craigslist ad, whatever. And this guy hits me up, and he's actually in LA, and he's all like, I'm into being humiliated by pies. I'm like, oh, okay, cool. So he, David the pie guy, would only wanted cream pies. He wanted cream or cake batter, which is yellow or pink, and that's it. You can never use chocolate, all right? So the way I was supposed to greet him at his house is I go to his house and I was supposed to pie him. So I'm going there with my pie. And like, he someone's his door, I'm like, what are you doing? So I just find him, and he just got really off at that. And I was like, this is so weird. So to me, it just opened this whole can of worms almost, like where I started exploring my own sexuality, and I started exploring my own fetishes in terms of what people desire. And so David was the first one who started helping me understand the whole idea of like, you know, you don't necessarily have to put this and that in order to be sex, but it can be also be a feeling of it. So I really started really capturing him as first, and then I started moving on to other things. I did other ads. I was like, Craigslist again. Anybody into maple syrup? Anybody into cake batter? So I was just like throwing things out, and there's people out there. It was so crazy. So it was a way for me, as I'm coming out, I'm also thinking about how I can document my experiences. So kind of like this is my coming out right here. Like, it's getting dirty. Let's get dirty and let's get to business, right? So if you want to go to the next slide, these are just pictures of David in terms of like, this is cake batter. So it was only yellow cake and white cake. And so there was like this whole process of getting to that point where to be, the one with the pie was just for humiliation. For this one, it was like this whole process where he would remember, it was memories of his mother baking cakes in his house, right, as a kid. And so I was like, wow, this is so crazy that we're going somewhere else with this, right? We're going into like this whole psychology of behind what's going on. So in order for me to get into this point, I had to sit there and bake a cake. So I had to do the cake batters and do all this stuff. And it was like 16 different bowls of different things. I was like, da-da-da. And then I get the chocolate, and he freaks out because it was chocolate batter. I was like, oh, weird. Anyways, so that's the vanilla and lemon. Let's go. That's his booty. But I was just really fascinated by the way we eroticize men's body. I was also fascinated the way it covered you. It's almost like this protective layer for these men. There's some more. So in a lot of it, you know, it goes back to the whole aspect of like when you come and you're like, there it is, it's a big show. So that's why I kind of love this image so much. It's like, wow, it's just like so much. I can't handle it, but I love it at the same time. You know, it's like, I'm grossed out by it, but I'm also like intrigued, right? Let's go to the next one. So I also found another guy from Texas who was into, what is he called, clay slip? But he liked being suffocated with the whole material. So he would sit there, and I was like, I need to get some help with this. And so I called my friend who's a psychologist, because I really needed to figure out what was going on, right? And so he was really into this whole idea of being choked by the substance, right? So he would use the acrylic paints and clay slip in order to create these, where he wanted to become a statue, right? So here we are talking about like this desire who is now, when now it's making it into like this art where it's like, it's these temporary statues, these temporary monuments, right? And there he is, look at, he's choking. And I was like, what do I do? So then I'm like, oh my hell. So then I go to an art show, and it was on Chicano art. And then again, it brings up the whole question of what is Chicano art? And I figured, well, I'm Chicano, so I might as well just do something, right? So this was my friend who was a drag queen who loved maple syrup, but not in a way that she fetishized it, but more into like in her pancakes. So I'm like, hey, how about if you like maple syrup all over your body and let's see how that's like, you know? So then I started throwing powdered sugar at her and chocolate syrup and like that. Oh my God. And then what happens is that she ends up being like really into it, that started making it her own fetish. I'm like, oh my God, am I like the fetish master now or what? So then the maple syrup dripping down. So then I'm like, well, since I'm photographing everybody, I might as well do myself, right? So this is right before I crack my rib, because I slip. So if I recommend that you guys do, don't do chocolate syrup on the cement floor at an angle, because then you'll slip it back to ribs like I did. So these are a series of self-portraits I did with chocolate. And so the whole idea behind it is just like fetishizing, and then it's still about loss, it's still about desire. It's when you see the show inside the gallery, it's all about loss and desire, and it's all about friends I've lost to HIV, and how we can, sometimes substitute our need for to be loved by sex, by this desire. And so two of the pieces that you see up there are two canvases that were the remnants of people putting on body paint, well, not body paint, but acrylic paint, and it was HIV negative, HIV positive, intermixing within the canvas. And so we never know where, you know, what the idea behind it. We never know like who was what. We never know who was positive, we never know who was negative, right? And then within the interaction with the paint, you kind of create your own story, right? So in the show, you'll see that, and you also see two videos, one of a queer immigrant rights activist being painted into a white wall, sort of whitewashing, and the other one is based on me removing my body hair and repainting my beard with a lipstick, and this whole aspect of masculinity and femininity. So, I don't know, did I answer you guys' questions, I think? Or I just said dirty.
I want to.
You guys said dirty. I like chocolate.
Thank you so much. And then, Ruben, if you want to share kind of your journey
for
your artistic.
I didn't know we were going to go way back, but I went to 5 months. About growing up, I grew up in a border town in El Paso, across from Guadalajara. And I grew up in, I was raised by my, this is a weird, convoluted story. I was raised by my lesbian aunt, which she insisted we call her mother, because after her sister died, my bio mom, she insisted on all us four kids to kind of play that facade in a way, because she's a lesbian and she wasn't really out. We didn't get the full story till in our teens, and she had a girlfriend for the longest time. And we were a little bit jealous of her because she got a lot of the attention. But I grew up in a very liberal household, and my mom worked at a dry cleaner's, but she had an artist soul. Looking back now, I think she was a really cool mom, you know. It's really interesting because we did not grow up religious. I remember one time, the twice a year that we go to church on Sunday, I told her one time, I'm an atheist, I'm an atheist. And I was really young, and then she said, no, we'll talk about it later. So that was kind of like the household I grew up in. And in our late teens, we used to go to the gay bars with our closeted closeted mom. Yeah. And she had a lot of gay friends, and she was, so she in a way introduced me to that world, which is very interesting. And I met really, you know, wonderful gay men that were very creative. They were singers, they were dancers, they were a stereotype of a, you know, a faggoty artist, which I loved. And I've always lived in that world, so I don't know any other world. And I think I was born an artist, because I was encouraged to do artistic things, and I would do a lot of strange things. I will give you a list later. But my mother was very, and it kind of like, she knew I was, I guess, somehow special, I guess. And then my other three brothers are pretty straightforward, you know, Chicano boys. I do have a younger brother, but he's into drag, that's another story. He was Miss El Paso, so look it up. I think it was mid-80s. So I grew up with that environment, and I've always been creative. I've always made a living as an artist, whether it be on the commercial side or the fine art side. But I love mixing those two worlds, and not really, you know, how that, I don't know why that is defined commercial, but we can go into a whole discussion about that. But so I've always been creative, and I've always been an artist. And even as a kid, which I still do, I give myself projects. But you can put the slides now. I wanted to show this too, because I've been kind of creating for the last 10 years, but not only am I an artist, but I'm also very interested in curating. Because, you know, I love artists, and I love creative people because of the introductions brought to me by my mother with all these wonderful creative people. And it was always a beautiful time with these very interesting and gay people. And so I'm also kind of documenting and curating, and these are some of the people that are here, that you see at the top. And this is like a Chicano collective that I was personally involved from Miguel 95 to 2000. And I did some installations, but I also did the graphic design and some of the more current kind of like collateral, if you will, of the shows and exhibitions. And so these are some of the kids that were involved at that time. I think Queer Kids all the time, and somebody really liked it, so I you know, because I like the idea of creative people being children, where they're, right, you know, experiment and try different things. Next slide. Oh, this is a project that I worked on, and it discussed the disparity between the mega rich, because I'm from Los Angeles, and the very, very poor. And we were all given a card to express whatever or create whatever thing you wanted to do. And I did it for myself to kind of transform myself to a young trans woman. My name was Trixie. Yeah, gave myself a project. But this project was given to me. And so, I imagine myself like a Chicana, a trans girl, and the reason that it's titled Home Free, because sometimes young LGBT kids, the street is a better alternative than the home life, which I never understood but in my research, I found that out. It's like, they'd rather be on the street than, you know. So I find that heartbreaking. So I decided that I wanted to do some sort of fabulousness, you know? and so, because if I were a young trans Chicana, what would I want to be? I didn't want to be sorrowful and, oh, pity me. I wanted to be fabulous, right? So I'm the party, right? I got a disco ball, I got some shoes. And then I also wanted to do the wants and needs. What is it that I want? And so I wanted to have to be real, you know, because when your girlfriend got to keep real. I mean, I'm homeless, but I'm still hoping to get a good fuck. I want true love and friendship. I want to be safe, you know, because sometimes you're not safe from my research, the harassment from the police and people in authority. 40 is pretty horrific. I mean, I've heard stories, so don't get me wrong. And of course, you want to be strong and fierce, right? So these were the wants, and I was very happy with these. And there was about 50 artists or something, and they all did amazing different things, but this is my piece. Next. This is another project that I gave myself. I was at a gay club in West Hollywood, and we were running around getting drunk, and we were just talking about all kinds of stuff, and this young gentleman we brought up and all of these other kind of things that happened in the 80s and 90s, and that kid has no clue what ACT UP was. It's like, what? And of course, I kind of didn't go on about that. So the project that I gave myself is to reproduce protest signs from the LGBT or queer community from the 60s to now. And since I have the technical know-how as also a graphic designer, I recreate all these signs. And so, actually Miguel helped me with this project too. And so I just, you know that old saying, you build it and you create people and then people call you and like that. So I literally called the city of West Hollywood. I said, I'm working on this project. I want you to come see it. Would you be interested in doing some sort of mock rally? And they're like, yes, we're very interested. And so this actually happened at Gay Pride 2016. But to push it one step further, my friend Miguel Angel Reyes is here. He said, everybody's going to wear like period clothes. It's like, Miguel, I don't think I have the time to do that. But if you do, knock yourself out. And sure enough, a lot of kids showed up with like 80s. And,
yeah.
And the person holding the banner to my left, that's my husband of 20 years. So, and so we call it From the Archives to the Archives, meaning that I take from the archives, reproduce it, and then at some point it's going to go back to the archives, which is kind of a, that's weird. And then Queer Sounds at the Times, I just worked that out with the city of West Hollywood. So this was a mock rally for, this was the day after the Orlando. And these are all, look, you have to realize that in LA, there's a collaborative energy that happens there. You unite people and you say, I'm building this thing. Come help me. And so that's what we do there. Oh, okay. This is I'm exhausted. I give myself too many projects. This is a project that I promised myself because I take this asshole's presidency very personally. Sorry. And so I promised myself that every month I would do an anti-Trump piece. I call it an anti-Trump visual because I don't know what I'm going to do. So for January, I created this sign, and then I send a lot of people in LA. I said, hey, can I install this at the club? So I called one of the clubs, said, I'm going to hang this and take pictures of my faggot friends in front of them. And they said, sure, we'd love to. And so I did that, and I took tons of pictures of people posing in front of it. And they could do whatever, like be really Nelly, Butch, whatever the hell they wanted to do. So that was the January. And then February was kind of on the ACT UP posters. And I also wrote the copy, and if I can, if you send me an email, I'll send you the copy. It's really funny. Evading taxes. Hugate, it's about the weird orangey complexion of the president. And then this one, March, was the Ides of March. And so I thought, and so every month I have to think of something new. And so I thought, Ides of March, March. And then I published it March 15th, tax time. And so that's about it. And all this artwork is available for free to anybody that wants it. So I'll send you like a vector file of the artwork. And then this fourth one, I kind of phoned in because I was really busy that month. We're still on. It's a post-it note. And so I used orange tape to do the face of Trump. And then, again, with the taxes. And so I, put Let Him Be Cake, kind of like that. What's her name? Mary Antonio?
Yeah.
Yeah.
so, you know, so I thought that was pretty appropriate for that.
This is my digital work. And I love doing these. It's all digital. It's either original imagery that I create and that I scan in or photograph, and then I take images from the glut of imagery and information that's out in the world, and I just do this. And sometimes I throw things and it creates this interesting narrative, right? And so I take, like, Pasco was one of my paintings that I did in the 90s. So, oh, I like the way that looks, so I put that there. And then there's a Robert Longo piece there. And then there's this, I don't remember that specifically, that Turkish incident that somebody killed the ambassador.
Yeah.
In the Russian ambassador. Yeah. And then I also watch a lot of porn, so I copy. And some Warholian elements. And I wanted that kind of bitmap background that's kind of comes to you from doing graphic design. Graphic design is kind of
boring.
And then what happens, so each piece is a continuation of, so for example, and then they're either reproduced as prints or as hopefully light boxes, right? Mm-hmm. And so if I finish this piece, this is number 19, so number 20 would have the banana and then other shit going on. And then I take that one element and then other shit going on. So it's kind of this flux of information and imagery that is constant, you know? And it's exhausting, so I'm trying to create some sort of beauty, I guess, if you will, some sort of narrative that speaks of whatever. I'm also a curator. I have no idea how to, I didn't go to, is there a curating school or something? But I just like putting together art and inviting people to do things or to put together an exhibition. And in this particular case, the Gay and Lesbian Center asked me to put together an exhibition of Latinx, you know, the spectrum of LGBT folks. Here, there, everywhere just came to me like boom. And I thought, well, it's kind of cheating, okay? But I don't know. And I kept thinking about it, you know, and so now I like it. And so it's a group show that has LGBT queer artists, Joey and Miguel are in it. And it's also cross generational, so we have some Latinos and some new queeros. And this is an altar that I've built around my blood drawing, which is also, there's another one, I did two. There's one here at the exhibition and then this particular one. And I wanted to build an altar. Now grant you, I'm an atheist, and we didn't grow up with altars, but I understand the significance of it. And so I use that as some sort of a vehicle to tell the story of sadness and I asked folks to bring flowers, and everybody did, and so I thought it was a beautiful thing. And that's it, all my projects.
Thank you so much for sharing both stories about childhood and then also the work that you've been working on. Afterwards, we end at 5, but there'll be time for folks to see the exhibit and then also the opening reception, and you'll be able to see what we have on display, a lot of connections from the stories they told. So Jesus and I were in a writing group, and my work looking at Chicano Latina performance, some of the folks in my projects are also queer, and so we often talked about in our writing groups intersectionality. How do you write about folks, and how do you write about artists in a way that doesn't box folks into these, like, kind of prescribed, this is what a Chicano is, or this is what a queer person is, right? Because we're so complex, and we definitely hear that in the narratives that you shared with us. So the next question we have is to think about how do you draw from inspiration from your identities as queer Chicanos, and also how do you feel like you push those boundaries? That's something Jesus was really interested in, right, is the way that you bring your complexity into the work that you're producing.
Let's go this way. I don't know, I have to think about that.
Well, I used to be part of this Chicano collective, and I used to kind of fight it because I thought it's ghettoizing and it's putting you in a specific box. And so I always used to say, I'm an artist that happens to be Chicano, but I am not a Chicano artist. I go, huh? So it's because my subject matter and my practice was not Chicano. But it does come from Western white tradition, I found out today. and that's where it comes from. But it comes out through the traditions we grew up with. I mean, I am Mexican American, I am Chicano. So even if you try to do some sort of minimalist Western European notion of an art installation, it'll seep out because that's who you are.
Yeah.
And as much, because I used to do push the envelope and create these new pieces of work, and I thought it was something terribly new and nobody's ever seen this. And then it turns out it's Mexican American art because you use the colors of the sarape. You know, you can't help it. And Miguel was telling me something, we had a conversation today about how Chicano artists kind of use color from the tubes, and they don't really make, I mean, I didn't know that. But my take was that I'm using colors from the tubes because I was being a pop artist, and I was using market-tested tubes paint, so I had a strange duality where it's like, it's also very Chicano to use those primary colors and,
I keep on thinking about Gloria Sandoval's Nepantla, Hospital Nepantla, where you're neither from here nor from there. And I think that's a constant negotiation we have as artists. Like, when I used to exhibit a lot, it was like, I would get called for Dead, and I would get called for Cinco de Mayo. Right? And I'm like, what happened to the rest of the fucking year, right? during the summertime, right? And so I think it, like, when you negotiate your own identity, it's like different spaces require different things. Like some of the things I was showing, like was one of the splashing series was shown at a place in San Diego, and it was very like macho, very like Chicano power kind of thing. And I was like, fuck it, I'm gonna show it, you know? Because that's who I am. I come from the movement, I also come from queer activism, and so it's a marrying of both, right? And so, it's something that I feel like a lot of artists, we're still fighting for that space within institutions, and I feel that we still have a long way to go, right?
I don't know, I came from South Texas, so I growing up, I never really heard of the word Chicano. I mean, it wasn't until I moved to Chicago, and then I moved to California that people started to say, like, oh, you're a Chicano artist. And I go, oh, well, you know, what does that mean? You know, and they were like, well, Mexican American. And I go, oh, yeah, you know, I definitely am. And there was a lot of work that I did see from Chicanos that I really gravitated towards just because I felt this. I think there's something within the Chicano artwork that ties all of it together. And even though I never considered myself a Chicano artist, I do see myself as a Chicano artist today because I think there's this level of identity where you feel like you're living two worlds and yet those two worlds are not fully accepting you, you know, to be part of their world. And to me, I feel like there's this level of wanting to be part of something bigger, yet, you know, still feeling a little ostracized. And just add the queer element to that, it makes me feel like even more ostracized, you know? So I think, you know, now I'm starting to feel this more connection than I used to in the past. And I'm very proud of that. I think in the past I probably would have been like, well, I'm an artist and that's it. But I think for some reason is, you know, as you get older or what, you appreciate any group that is willing to accept you. And I think for me, I'm just appreciative of anybody who's willing to accept me and my work, you know. But I find that the Chicano community has been very accepting of a lot of the images that I've been creating and everything. So, you know, I keep pushing myself thinking,
a lot about the conversations I had with Jesus, where, to tell the truth, I think he really made me question this whole, the whole question is, what makes you a Chicano artist? Why do you connect with them? And, you know, how do you keep pushing yourself? And, you know, I mean, just the fact that I can be part of this community is really good. It's really good for me. And I know that I'll keep pushing towards it. So hopefully people might be more teaching.
But I also think that it's, a lot of times we have to create these movements, we have to create these spaces. Like, none of us would be here today, like, that's in the exhibit, if it wasn't for Miguel Angel, who put this show together, the Homometer show at South Hall Graphics.
That's true.
And in the 30 years that South Hall Graphics has been in East LA, there has never been, like, a queer dedicated show. And that happened in 2010?
It was a while back, yeah.
This happened last year. But there has been the shows with queer artists since then, right? And so I think that we have to cultivate these spaces and we have to take over the spaces in order to be banded together.
Yeah, I think it's important, like, for example, I started the Queer Biennial and I used to bitch at my friends. Not want to bitch, I like to get shit done. But as I don't see artwork out there, and I used to joke around with my friends, you know, most institutions and museums create artwork for and by 35-year-old white men. And that was a joke, and I would never say it out loud. And I would even share that with my white friends, and they're like, hee. And so I thought, so I'm sure that the Chicano art movement or that school is kind of similar to the Queer Biennial, where it's like, shut the fuck up and do something about it. And so if you want to label it and say Chicano or queer or whatever the fuck you want to call it, it's almost like something that's essential for people that are underrepresented to show their face. Because just our mere existence is our relevance, you know? So I think that's where it stems from too.
Right, and a follow-up question to that is, you know, oftentimes as artists of color, as queer artists of color, our work can get labeled as political no matter what, right? But at the same time, in hearing you all talk and having read the work that Jesus was writing about you all, each of you in your own ways working towards some type of social justice, whether it's in memory and thinking about issues of loss and desire, whether it's thinking about how do you create space for queer kids, as you were saying, right, or tying into what Anzaldúa would talk about, some type of spiritual activism and your work with curanderismo. And so I would love to hear your thoughts about, you know, what inspires this work that you're doing to work towards social justice. That's one of the really broad themes that we have for this symposium, perhaps even starting with, like, you know, do you see your work as working towards social justice? How does it connect? And what are the important spaces that you're creating through your artwork? Especially, right, given these times that we keep talking about.
Well, for me, I think growing up in America, there was always this level of shame. Mm-hmm. This level of shame that white people, or people just from a different culture, would give you for, one, you know, having so many weed heads in your house, you know, or so many crosses, and, you know, this constant, you know, rosary, and just like this constant religious aspect and the spiritual aspect of our lives. And I think for me, you know, in my work, I really want to show the beauty of this. And I want to show that it's not just something that somebody can take and make into t-shirts or something, you know, it's like make it, capitalize on it. I want to show that there's a beauty in the teachings, and not only the teachings, but also, there's a beauty in believing in something that you feel connected to. And so my work, yes, it does bring attention to this aspect of living this sort of half-Mexican, half-American lifestyle. And so it really, for me, the social justice comes when I try to fight for people to believe in what they need to believe in, and to treat people all the same. And I think that when I do my work, it has a lot to do with openness and freedom of expression. And I think that's where my work comes into that. I don't think my work's very political per se, like, you know, talking about one thing, but I'm so driven towards spirituality and allowing people of faith to believe in what they want to believe in. I really, really, really big on that.
Great.
think about Chicanos, and especially growing up, my father's a deacon and in the Catholic Church, and so it's also kind of hitting with a lot of secrecy and not talking about your desires and not talking about who you are as a person. So I think that in the work I do with social justice, that can be, it doesn't have to be labeled as, well, I'm a queer artist, as I'm working for justice for the women of Juarez who are been disappearing throughout the desert landscape, or I'm bringing up issues of like incest in our family, right? Or I'm bringing up issues about a loss due to HIV and AIDS, but it's just like our way to storytell, right? And we're storytellers, and I feel like as artists, that's our job. It's like we create that visual to tell that story. So if it comes up to social justice, I think like, yeah, you're speaking up, and that's your activism right there.
I mean, as artists, we kind of pay attention to our own psyche, our surroundings. And if you really pay close attention, you have to do that kind of work, I think. Especially now, because people of color are under attack, I feel. And so I think if you're an artist in some sort of way that you can kind of create work that speaks to that, I think it's very important. But not all my work is pertain to social justice or Chicano art. Sometimes I have, to be fancy, quite a fancy, where I want to do a painting purely for the joy of the color blue, or whatever the hell it is. And sometimes that's kind of a nice respite, because when I start doing these Trump pieces, it gets me really fucking angry. And so it's nice to somehow just say, you know, I'm going to do a piece about meditation and the beauty of blue, or whatever the fuck it is, you know, it's like, so, but I think if you really pay attention, you have to do that kind of work, you know, whether it be social, political, or ethno issues, or any kind of, you know, social justice issues. I think if you really pay attention, it seems in there, right?
I, and I think you hit on something, it's like, yeah, not everything's gonna be political, not everything's gonna be social justice, but you have to learn that technique as well. Yeah, you know, like right now I'm learning how to do ceramics and I'm like, I'm loving it. It's like, oh, but I have to do the basics. I have to do all these fucking pots, like pots, more pots, more pots, right? And so in order for me to get to where I wanna go, I have to learn the basics. I have to learn those techniques. And then I think with any artist, like, you know, there's a lot of artists I get together, like let's do a drawing session or whatever. But you have to master your techniques as well.
And I think also the times, I think that there was a moment in time, maybe a few years ago, where a lot of people were doing like just stuff that they felt they wanted to do. But I think when Trump came into being president, I think a lot of people felt very, almost like we don't want to work on our personal, we want to work on something political, we want to express this anger. And so I think a lot of people, it just depends on the times. I mean, sometimes we're going to look more inwards. And I think when there's a lot of political strife, then we start looking outwards, you know? And I think that in this time, I think I'll probably see a lot more political stuff than I'll probably be also working towards a lot more political things than I did in the past, just because I feel this need to speak out, you know? So I think it just depends on the times as well.
So I'm actually interested in to see how your work is perceived in Spain since you've been living there. Is it different than it would be here in the States?
I have like this whole experience about Spain. Everyone thinks it's glamorous and everything, but I fell into a depression for 2 months, and it's like nobody wants to hear that. They're like, boo-hoo. And I'm like, but still, I mean, it's a very interesting, and by the way, being Chicano, and I think being here in Chicano, it was a very interesting to speak to Spanish people. I am living in Valencia, and of course, I went in there really eagerly, and oh, about art, and what do you think about Mexico, and everything. And it was very strange to actually have people tell me that Mexico is actually Spain's. They're like, I actually had a person say, well, you know, Spain is supposed to have Mexico. Mexico was very lucky that the Spaniards, you know, invaded. And this was, yeah, and this was like a shock to me, and I was like, well, you know, I don't know anybody who could tries to get conquered this happy. And so I had this really odd, seriously, I even felt that there was this xenophobic attitude towards darker skinned individuals, and it just it was a very eye-opening experience. And so when I was showing people the artwork, I think at the art studio that I was working, people were very receptive. They were very like, oh, that's interesting. Yeah, you know, it's indigenous, you know. I was talking about the curanderos, and a lot of people were very receptive about it. But when just average people that you knew, like your neighbors and all that, looked at the work, they all just looked at it as a little primitive. And I thought that that, to me, was a little sad, because I felt like, you know, I felt like they didn't understand it, but there was a reason they didn't understand it, because there wasn't a connection there that we and our culture constantly pushes. And so, personally, I felt very special, but I also felt very ostracized. I felt more ostracized there than I did here. And then I came back here, and I'm like, oh, America. But, you know? But then I've been eating a lot of crap food, and I was like, oh, America, I want to go back. It was just, I'm serious, like I'm in this love-hate thing right now.
Well, they have skinheads in Spain, because I've been to Spain.
Yeah, it's a very strange, it's a very strange world, but nobody wants to talk about it. But I mean, like, they had like stuff like horchata, and I said, oh, you know, in Mexico they have horchata too, and you know, my, you know, you drink it. They're like, oh, but it's different. And I'm like, so you get this really weird attitude, almost like, you know, and I mean, they just, in many ways, you kind of feel like they feel that Mexico is inferior. And yet you do have, I probably met 4 Mexicans there, and they all worked at a Mexican restaurant. And it's just, you know, there's just this attitude, and it wasn't what I thought it was gonna be. And I think that's what really depressed me, and I think I fell into this depression for a few months, and it was very difficult, but I'm glad I didn't leave. I'm glad that I decided to stay and kind of let it toughen me up a little bit to come back and say, you know, I was in hell, but it was really, it's a nice experience. I think it really built me, but it was different.
Thank you so much for that question. At this time, we'll open it up to the audience. We have some time for a few questions. Yes?
This is for Luciano. Can you tell me more about like the pieces that you have in the show? You referenced, I think it was the technique that you said you worked on. Like,
Sanguina?
Yes, yeah. Could you tell us what that technique is?
I think probably Miguel Angel would know more about that, but it's a pencil that they use. A lot of older artists use it for sketching and stuff, and it's just an old technique. And for me, I didn't know much about Sanguina, so I actually went in there in the studio to talk about to work on with charcoal. Never worked with charcoal. I thought it was like an old way of working, and I wanted to get some foundation, you know, techniques down. And I thought, and I really did think, because I was using a lot of graphites, it just was difficult using graphites and photographing them. And they also didn't have that quality that I wanted to capture, which was something a little bit more ancient or something a little bit older. And so I started working with charcoal, and my teacher, my professor, he goes, have you ever tried sanguina? And I go, no, I don't know much about that. And he goes, it's in sort of like an older way of using. A lot of people use it. A lot of older artists used it to sketch and everything. And I think it would lend a lot of the feeling that you're trying to capture with these pieces. But the only problem is that there's not many shades. So I really had to work on how to create shades with that and everything. But that's how I really started doing it. And I mean, it's an old way of drawing. But I'm trying to kind of use a modern twist to it. But I don't know if
it's a creamier than charcoal, basically.
Okay.
It's creamier. I mean, you just put it on and go, and then you're just like, oh my god. Seriously, like, it just all went up. It's like, it just like dust is everywhere. It's like really difficult to use. But I'm very, very happy to be working with it, because I do think it adds something to it, and I hope that people will really see it in person. Will appreciate how much work it was to master something like that. And I have yet to really master it, but I've been working with it for about a year. So.
Other questions? Yes.
So, I guess this could go for all the three of you, but I know, Rigo, you mentioned your activism work in undergrad and whatnot, and it kind of reminded me of kind of how I started as well in undergrad, just kind of like art also fell on my lap too, right? Like I just wanted to do documentaries, and then I just got into graphic design, and then after graduating, because I was involved on, you know, organizing students of color on my campus, I got into organized community organizing, and sort of like my art sort of just kind of like never really took off because I kind of like set that aside and focused more on organizing. And now that I'm trying to like get back into it, trying to plug back in, I almost feel like there's this disconnect between the me that like really desired this and the me now that feels like I can't do it because, you know, I missed out on a couple years, or because, you know, I feel like I wasn't able to, you know, or maybe it's just something that I don't see as like sustainable, even though I love, you know. And sometimes it's just hard because, you know, there's mental health issues, there's X, Y, and Z things that happen that don't allow you to do that. So for you, for all three of you, what would you say to someone who's, you know, young and trying to do something with their art, but feels like they have, you know, all these, you know, mental health or whatever it is they have on their plate that isn't allowing them to like really pursue that in a way that's honoring like their spirit and their being?
I think when I first started out, just showing, I would start off at coffee shops or whatever. But then I started kind of taking that power and creating the shows, curating them, and inviting my friends, like, hey, you have paint something? Yeah, let's get it together. So I think that's where I like really got my artwork out there, is when I started collaborating with other people and creating your own spaces. And I think that's like the key, because now we have social media and you can just advertise like crazy. Before, it was not like that, right? Now you can go to Instagram and Snapchat or whatever, and you have to have like a tagline. Almost you have to have people come into your spaces. But I think just by creating spaces for yourself, I think that's really important that you have to do that, because if you're gonna wait for somebody to come around and tell you, hey, do you wanna be in a show? You're gonna be waiting for a long time, right? I think I know that's for me. I decided to create my own shows. So, and just based on that, like, there's three different scholars writing about the work I did in the beginning of the years, where I was organizing and I was doing these shows. And that's how I did the big, we started bringing light to what was happening in Mexico with the women of Juarez who were disappearing. And so I brought in my activism work, I brought my organizing skills, but I also created work for the exhibit. So it was a way to marry all three things together into one space.
I think I'll just touch on the mental health problem. I personally have had depression for a very, very long time. I take medicines for my depression. I have anxieties. I think it's odd because to be able to be an artist and to get out there and work, it's a struggle and it's really, really difficult. I think that when it comes down to it, you have to know that you really want to do it, because even something like this is incredibly difficult. I mean, I know for me, you know, people are always like in Los Angeles, like, oh, you know, I have a show and all that. I go when like no one's there. That's when I go, you know. It's like, I'll be like, oh, you're gonna go, no one's there, I'll go. But I don't really go to too many openings and stuff like that. And, you know, it's a constant battle to try to be out there but not be out there, because, you know, you're, you know, depressed or you feel anxious or all that. And I think that at the end of it, it shows a lot of determination when people really start realizing, like, look, yeah, I do have depression. Yeah, I do have anxieties, but I know that I have to express myself. I know that I have to put some of me out there, because this is part of my journey. This is who I am. And I think in the end of it, I think that if you can look back, like for me at least, if something should happen to me, I know that I put myself out there, whether it's people gravitated or not, but I know that I put myself out there, and I just didn't allow these physical limitations or these mental limitations really dictate what I want to do with my life. And it's, I mean, essentially it's, you know, it's a constant battle in your head and your body, you know, to do this. So my thing to you would be that you have to keep fighting, you have to keep going, you know. I mean, what's the purpose in many ways, you know, moving forward in life if you're not fighting and going for the things that really connect you to this planet, to this world?
art is a spiritual and emotional connection, you know, to inspire this world.
I just think keep on creating, because I think all of us have works that, not even up here, it's not there, it's not whatever. We have tons of work, right? But it's a way for, I use my artwork as a form of therapy, so I have shit all over my house, where like it doesn't, like, if it doesn't make it in the gallery, it's going to make it in my yard, or my
or
someone's
rat's house.
Yeah, but it's just, it's a survival skill for me as well, is just to keep on creating, whether like I'm going through something, whether I don't finish it or not. I have tons of shit that it's like, there you already started, but I'll come back to it like 2 years later or whatever. But as long as you have it in you to keep on creating and just store it or whatever and come back to it, it's all good.
Well, I think it's important to, if you want to be an activist and all of that, is to be, just get out there and do it and be pretty organized. I know that I partition myself. Like, for example, if I'm doing a body of work, I kind of block everything else out till later. And the activism with me just happened through some weird osmosis where, like, for example, the Queer Zen of the time, was like just a very practical project for me because I loved signage and graphic design, and then it turned into kind of an activist moment for me, and I was very passionate about it, and people saw that, and so that particular body of work is taking me somewhere else where now I'm part of a show and other venues, and then people are very much interested in kind of being a part of that somehow. And so if you follow your passion like that, people will find you because they see it that you're really honest and truthful about it. So, you know. And then you don't have to change the world. You know, you just do an increment, you know, just a little thing, and then build on that. If you go out there and say, I'm gonna, you know, do some sort of magical installation to change the world, I mean, it's great that you think that way because you need the passion, but if you do it little by little, it kind of adds.
And I just want to add, sometimes I think that a lot of people, or some people, they think of their mental disease or some physical restraint, they think of it as a crutch. They think of it as like, oh, this is stopping me. This is like the worst thing in my life. If I didn't have this, I'd be like, I'd be doing all this. But I think you have to think of those things as empowering. Those are the things that you see, you feel, and those are elements that you can use in a positive manner. That you can use in your work that other people are not using. And I think that by switching that idea to saying these things are keeping me from actually expressing myself, they should be the catalyst to why you're expressing yourself. And I think that your works will be more powerful by accepting those parts of you, because none of us are perfect, but by accepting our flaws or the things that we think are our flaws, and sort of pushing them onto artworks, I think will create really powerful and very emotional pieces that I think will definitely connect, and I think you yourself will start feeling much more accepting of who you are as well. And I think it will, it's just a cycle, it will continue and continue, and who knows, you know, where it will take you.
Thank you.
One more question, Joey?
Yeah, this isn't a question, I don't want to presume, but I wanted to respond to what you said there and follow up on these guys. I would say, and when I have found myself in those, you know, moments where it's like, oh my God, I haven't done anything in a month or 2 months, go look at art.
Mm-hmm.
Go look at comic book art. Go look at religious paintings. Go look at 18th century portraiture. I mean, stuff that is so, you know, not in the usual vein, and it's surprising sometimes, and especially if I'm in a mood, mm-hmm. my response to the work, and it kind of, you know, percolates in my head. So I would just, you know, when all else fails, go look at art.
Yeah.
That's
take it in.
Yeah.
Okay. One last question, please.
Thank you very much for the conversation we're having today. You know, part of what Assis is trying to do was he really saw that all of your work was speaking to each other and was asking similar questions, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, yet at the same time, Ruben, you mentioned that the coming together of queer Chicano artists to show their work in the same space and to have that conversation is a rare thing. And so I was wondering if you could talk about some of the challenges in being able to speak to each other in these kinds of spaces in Los Angeles. Because even though Los Angeles is dynamic art scene, it's also very, you know, it's a car culture.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
very hard to even just see each other on a frequent basis because it's you know, it's a people are spread out. So if you could speak to some of those issues, like how do you overcome some of the challenges of
Uber.
No, well, like for example, I'm curating a show, I'm putting together an exhibition 2018, and I started planning it the end of 2016. Because along with that, I want to do studio visits, visit the artist, so that if once the exhibition is up, somebody, you'd be like a great docent, you know, you could tell, say everything, and you know, he's 25, he's Chicano, likes wearing pumps, you know, and so that gives it a beautiful layer to the story. So I think again, it's compartments. It's like plan things, and then and also we're having this conversation last night. Learn how to say no too. If somebody says, "I want you to be part of this show of calaveras or whatever," I'm like, "Well, I could draw me calavera, but I'd rather spend that time visiting artists like young Chicano artists or young queer because." I focused on queer of any race or whatever, and people of color in Chicano. And so, I think, I know as artists we're, you know, we have this stereotype that we're easy breezy, we go with the flow, which is true. And I go with the flow, but I'll give me a month's escape. This month is go with the flow. But in March, it's, you're gonna work with a worker, you know? So that's how I do it. And I'll say, okay, you have, I mean, I'm very strategic. I say, you have 12 artists that you have to go visit, and you have to be done with these studio visits by October 15th. And then I do this thing, and then you also have to like get drunk with your friends. And you know, so it's weird, but, and so when people see me sometimes where I'm like easy breezy, it's like I planned for that easy breezy time. You know, and they think I'm like that all the time, I'm a motherfucker. I'm working till 3 o'clock in the morning. So that I can really relish that time that I'm easy breezy, just kind of being beautiful. You know that room painting? So, I know artists hate that word strategizing, but if you want to get some shit done, you have to strategize. You have to have some sort of plan. But I'm always prepared, because I embrace failure, by the way. I embrace failure. And when I embrace failure, that's giving me the freedom, like you know, don't believe it. It's amazing, because you get run over by a truck tomorrow. But at least you know you have a set of plans, and then like you were saying that you had a video that you were going to show, and then there were some technical problems, and then you had some live singers. See, that's a magical moment. So I'm always prepared for those moments too. Yeah. I'll do that strategic plan, if you. You have to forgive my lingo because I'll speak on the commercial side and they use words like that. And I'm thinking, these guys build this fucking thing in 2 months? Because they strategize, they had plans, you know. But I also don't neglect my art side where I say, you know, for the next 3 days I'm gonna be a stinking drunk asshole, you know, and that's, you know. People think that
sounds nice.
Yeah, people think that that's, by life, no, it's just this particular time, that's when
It's interesting because I was talking to Joey about this. I've known Joey for like 10 years or so, but I've never met him until yesterday, which is really weird, right?
Yeah.
And so LA is a different piece, I think. It's a whole different, you know, it's a car culture. You know, so especially being queer men, because our spaces are even limited, because it's like whether it be the bar scene or whether it be art shows, you know, those are the kind of places that you see each other, right? So it was weird because I had never met Joey, but I've known of him, and then we found out just by talking that we've gone back many years back with the same circle of friends, you know? But it was just never, we never coincided with our existence together, you know?
Well, I met him before, I got familiar with him before I met him, and I met him today.
Yeah.
And it's almost like I knew him as an old friend because I was familiar with your work, you know? And people seeing us would think, oh, we've known each other for years. No, we've known of each other for
years.
I think we all like know each other, but not know each other.
Yeah,
we all know of each other's stuff.
Yeah.
I think for me, I work within this this sort of style called pop surrealism,
and Lowbrow, which was founded mostly in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And so right now in Los Angeles, there's this, like, this huge burst of art in the pop surrealism art world. So I think for me, as a Chicano Mexican American artist in this scene, I don't think I've ever really had an issue, but I never really worked too much. I mean, I worked with Miguel Angel on the Omonde show, but I don't think I ever crossed with that many people just because it was such a specific style that, you know, either you do pop surrealism or lowbrow and people are so specific about it. But having said that, I would love to do more Chicano art shows, you know? I would love to lend my ideas to those art shows, and I think, you know, I haven't been around for about a year, but I hope that within, when I come back, you know, that there'll be much more shows happening, and I'd be happy to partake in them. So, it's a very different part of my life, I think. Mm-hmm. I think in the past, I don't know how I would see it, but today I just want to be part of many different shows, I guess, and varieties.
Who would think it takes Minnesota to bring gay Chicano Los Angeles artists?
Yeah.
Well,
it's a reunion.
Right.
A reunion of non-reunion.
A non-reunion, yes. Please put your hands together and thank our panelists for the wonderful presentation.